in John Ford's work as an assistant director. And he said, give Jack Ford the job. He yells real good.
Recently, John Ford was discussing his beginnings with Peter Bogdanovich and said, I certainly had no desire to go into pictures or have anything to do with them. Still haven't. When asked how it happened then, he replied, hungry.
Frank Nugent asked Ford about the chase in Stagecoach. Why didn't the Indians just shoot the horses pulling the stagecoach? Ford replied, if they had, it would have been the end of the picture.
Frank Capra once said, John Ford is half tyrant, half revolutionary, half saint, half Satan, half possible, half impossible, half genius, half Irish, but all director and all American.
The American Film Institute presents A Salute to John Ford. Hosted by Danny Kaye, with guest appearances by Charlton Heston, Jack Lemmon, Maureen O'Hara, Jimmy Stewart, and John Wayne, with a special guest performance by Leslie Uggams. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States and Mrs. Nixon, and our guest of honor for the evening, Mr. John Ford. Chairman of the Board of Trustees of the American Film Institute, Mr. Charlton Heston.
You notice I made the entrance on time tonight. Clint, you can relax. We won't need you. Mr. President, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, tonight the American Film Institute has the privilege of presenting its first Life Achievement Award. This award has been established to pay tribute to the great architects of film and television, and in so doing, bring proper recognition to the motion picture as perhaps the prime artistic achievement of the United States in the 20th century. Tonight, the Institute is hosting this celebration to pay tribute to a man who has done as much as any man, if not more, to advance the art of film in the United States. It's been said that in a John Ford film, you can hear America singing. No, sometimes it sings with an Irish brogue. No individual has more fully explored in film the American experience. The Grapes of Wrath, The Last Hurrah, Stagecoach, Young Mr. Lincoln. These are but a few of the Ford creations. Altogether, John Ford's films are a a creative tapestry representing more than 50 years of a creative life, an artist's life. They meet the highest standards of career achievement in film art. Mr. Ford, the one thing you taught all of us was pacing, when to cut to the action. We don't have a company of cavalry here tonight, but we do have a troop of your friends. So who better to open the evening than a gentleman who's brought happy beginnings and endings to the world, to audiences all over, a star for whom the world is a stage, the United Nations ambassador to the world's children, and laughter's ambassador to the world of entertainment. I'm very proud to present your master of ceremonies, Mr. Danny Kaye.
Thank you very much, Mr. Heston, Mr. President, Mrs. Nixon, Mr. Ford, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. There was an air of excitement all day in this room. There was also a great deal of nervousness, I might add, because we were rather concerned about protocol. And all afternoon, the word on everybody's lips was protocol. Well, now, how do you do, Mr. certainly, Mr. President, you and Mrs. The whole problem is none of us know how to behave is what the problem is. I am the big expert on protocol. Some years ago, I was on a mission for UNICEF, and we had been in Europe. And we arrived in Austria, and I was in Vienna, and we met the mayor of Vienna, and we met the minister of health, and the minister of finance, and the minister of children, and the minister of almost every kind of ministry you have. And it was all very pleasant, and the next day they said, tomorrow you meet the president of Austria. I said, well, that's kind of lovely. So the next day we went to the president's mansion, and we walked through halls, doorways, anterooms, doorways, halls, anterooms, doorways. And we finally got into a room that's about the size of Dodger Stadium. And we stood in the middle of the room. I believe you know the room. We stood in the middle of the room, and from Brentwood came the president of Austria, who was then 81 years old. Now, he was straight as a ramrod, had short hair, closely cropped, white, and he limped across. And he came to the center of the room, and somebody said, Mr. President, His Excellency from the United Nations Children's Fund. And I stood. I was, that was me. So I bowed, and he said, well, we are delighted that you are able to come here to our country, because we have many things which we I'd like to show you here. We are also interested in the children's problems, and we like for you to see something which we have in our country. And I said, well, Mr. President, most of my life I've heard about your country, and I've read about it, and I've been told about it, and I look forward very much to seeing some of the great sights in your country and meeting some of the people in your country. And we talked, and we talked, and we talked, and we talked, and I got very nervous. He was 81 years old. He limped across the room, and we are now standing in the middle of the room. And I was shifting my weight from one leg to another, and nothing happened. And finally, I said, Mr. President, why don't we sit down? And he looked at me and said, I am supposed to ask you that. I said, well, ask me then. And with that, it suddenly occurred to me that protocol really has no barriers. And it is most clearly demonstrated by children. Traveling for UNICEF, we go to many, many places in the world, and we got to a place in Moscow. It was a little children's day camp, and they evidently told them that some people were coming from that place, meaning this country, you see. And they had a whole bunch of children lined up, and there was a beautiful little girl. Do you have any flowers over there? A little girl was standing at the gate, and we all came in, and the little girl came forward, and she said, Mr. Denike, all children of Soviet that we have many, Mr. Denike, the children of the Soviet with the day camp that we are all many, Mr. Denike, all children of Soviet that Mr. Denike, flowers. And so, Mr. President, we here as a group have in turn as we feel. Can we then not within the realm as we call Mr. President, flowers. All the bouquets tonight are really for John Ford. And you can't talk about John Ford really without talking about the movies. Now, in the history of the cinema, there have been three revolutionary developments. In 1889, Thomas Edison gave us the kinetoscope and the moving picture. In 1927, the Warner Brothers gave us vitaphone and sound. And in 1928, not to be outdone, John Ford gave us Marion Michael Morrison. Now, you out there, you may know him as John Wayne. Ladies and gentlemen.
President, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, Jack and lovely Mary. I could talk of Pappy, as we call him, or as Coach, as I call him, or as Admiral, as his country calls him. I could talk of him through personal experience and anecdote, but tonight I prefer to speak of him as the artist. He has done many things of many people that are brilliant pieces of artistry. But I choose to spotlight the Western tonight. In the short time that I'm allotted, I must use comparison. His lifestyle is similar to that of Charlie Russell. Pappy lived through the bright, wild, and undisciplined years of our industry when it was young. As Charlie before him lived through the wild and untamed West of years ago. They both have diligently, in their separate medium, portrayed the West as it was. Fascinating, adventurous, savage, and romantic. Pappy never compromised attitude or thought of the day. As always, Dame Progress had her way. It was said of the West that the sons of civilization, drawn by the fascination of a fresher and bolder life, thronged to the Western wilds in multitudes, which blighted the charms that had lured them there. The Wild West is tamed. Its savage charm has given way to irresistible commonplace. Charlie put it pretty well. The cowpuncher is history. The West is still a great country, but the picture and the story part of it have been plowed under. Jack Ford gives us in his work that part of legend and history that might have been lost forever to the American people. Of Jack Ford, the man, his friends and his country are more important to him than wealth or position or talent. I was lucky enough to be a part of what we lovingly call the Ford Stock Company. Now, he helped me through those rough years of early success and a certain amount of adulation, which is hard for the young and the immature to cope with. I love him. I could say more. Thank you. Being Irish, he has a way with wit and words. You're about to see a film clip of him at his articulate best.
Shoot.
Mr. Ford, you made a picture called Three Bad Men, which was a large-scale Western. You had a quite elaborate land rush in it.
Mm-hmm.
How did you shoot that?
With a camera.
Isn't The Sunshine's Bride kind of a little picture that you made for yourself? Would that fall in the same?
Uh-huh.
Mr. Ford, I've noticed that that your view of the West has become increasingly sad and melancholy over the years. I'm comparing, for instance, Wagon Master to the man who shot Liberty Valance. Have you been aware of that change in mood?
No.
Now that I point it out, is there anything you'd like to say about it?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Can I ask you what particular element about the Western appealed to you from the beginning?
I would know.
Would you agree that the point of Fort Apache was that the tradition of the army was more important than one individual?
Cut.
I think that most of you would agree that a man who has directed 140 films probably didn't waste too much time. Consequently, I don't think he spent much time in the front office discussing scripts or wardrobe or any of those things that he did on the set. He used to go down on the set and do his job and go about his business, and he loved it. Now, one day, a producer or head of a studio, I don't remember which, sent an assistant down to the set to tell Mr. Ford that he was one day behind schedule. And Mr. Ford looked at him. Now, when Mr. Ford looks at you, you have been looked at. And he said, how many pages am I supposed to shoot in one day? And the young assistant said, about 8 pages a day, sir. And Mr. Ford went about, and he counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. He said, tell your boss we're on schedule now. And you know something? He never did shoot those 8 pages. And it was a much better picture for it. But there are a lot of pages he did shoot, I must tell you. I mean a lot. And I'm sure that you'll all agree that many of the best pages were about a land he loved intensely, America. And our next guest has a very special importance for that reason. Over and above his enormous talents as an actor, in so many of John Ford's films, he has made the American West come alive. He also happens to be a gentleman of irresistible charm, delicious sense of humor, who, in his illustrious career, has talked back to an invisible rabbit, the Senate of the United States, and on one occasion, to John Ford himself. Ladies and gentlemen, to Jimmy Stewart.
Thank you, Danny. Thank you. Mr. President, Mr. Nixon, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to have this opportunity to pay my respects to John Ford. My first professional meeting with John Ford was a rather stormy affair. I'd been hired to work in a picture that he was directing, and before the picture started, I was told to report to his office at the studio for a meeting with Mr. Ford. And I assumed that it was for the purpose of discussing my part and the interpretation I had on the story and how I felt about the casting of the picture. But I was wrong. The hat that he wanted me to wear in the picture that I was going to do. And he had the hat there in the office, and I tried it on, and it was just a terrible hat. And I had a hat of my own that I'd worn in several pictures, westerns, and I wanted to wear this hat in this picture that I was doing with Mr. Ford, and I told him so, that I wanted to wear this hat, and we had a discussion about that. I think it was a discussion. But I after a while, I realized I wasn't getting anywhere. So I decided to appeal to the sentimental side of John Ford. So I said that this hat that I had that I wanted to wear was handed down to me by my grandfather. My grandfather gave it to my father, and my father gave it to me, which was absolutely untrue. But Ford didn't buy it. But then I said, the hat is a good luck hat. And it's a good luck omen for me. And I'm a very superstitious person, and it'll affect my work if I don't wear my good luck hat. And this seemed to get him. And he said, all right, you can wear your hat. But as I left the office, he stopped me, and he said, if by chance you ever work for me again, I want you to have in your contract a clause that states that you have hat approval. And fortunately, I did work for him again. in another picture, and I did have in my contract a thing that said I had approval. But John Ford won again, because in this picture, he didn't allow me to wear a hat at all. I'm very proud to know John Ford. I consider that I'm very fortunate to have been cast under his spell. I'm very grateful to him for the things that he has taught me about my profession, about my life. When I started working for him, I called him boss. I still call him that, because that's what he is to me, boss. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Leslie Uggam.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's a beautiful scene in Rio Grande where the company singers appear at twilight to serenade the commanding officer and his lady. Well, with your permission, Mr. Ford, I'd like to serenade you and your lady.
We come now to the John Ford Fellowship Award. It's an award for scholarship in the cinema. And to present it is one of the most exciting young movie stars of the past two decades. It's true. He's played everything from Daphne in Some Like It Hot to the unforgettable Ensign Pulver in Mr. Roberts. And next year, it just may be that for his performance in Save the Tiger, he'll be playing Win the Oscar. My friends, Jack Lemmon.
Thank God I'm not going to sing, I'll tell you that. Do something else, baby. Mr. President, Mrs. Nixon, Pappy, Mrs. Ford, ladies and gentlemen, and Danny, thank you very much. I'm delighted that you plugged Tiger. I'm more delighted that you said young. I can't believe that. But, I will tell you a story when I was young. The very first experience I had with Mr. Ford, about 20 years ago or so, he did a picture called The Long Gray Line. And, wait till you hear what happened. Aside from the lovely Miss O'Hara, there was a character in there, the leading male character, aged up to 80-some-odd years old, as I remember. And for some reason, the moguls at Columbia Pictures, where I was under contract, decided that John Euler Lemmon III, a magnificent, ultra-talented young man, should test for this part. Now, naturally, with the talent, the enormous talent that I had that almost matched my conceit, I picked a scene where I would be 80 years old. So I went through, for 8 hours a day, about 6 or 7 days of makeup. They built rubber pieces for my face. There was a cast made over my face with straws up my nose so I could breathe. While I sat for hours, they built a chin, a new nose, earlobes, eyebrows, a gray wig, all kinds of things. And then one Monday morning, at a bright and early hour, they put all of this stuff on me. It took about 5 hours, and I looked in the mirror, and my God, I was 80 years old. There's only one thing. You have to act 80 years old. And a very wonderful director named Richard Quine did his very best to evoke a performance from me. And I did the tests. In my opinion, magnificence. Pappy Ford apparently saw that little piece of film, and the lights went on, and he stood up and said, "That actor is the worst old man that I have ever seen in my life, but he could be a great Ensign Pulver." And that's how I got the part. So help me God. It's very true. Tyrone Power, and played it very well, did The Long Gray Line, and I got an Academy Award for giving a lousy test as an 80-year-old man. It's just one of those crazy things. But my hat is off to Mr. Ford. I will never, ever forget it. Among his many, many attributes, he's totally unpredictable, but I guess that's part of greatness and perceptiveness. At any rate, the stories about Mr. Ford are legend, as they are about other great directors. That's just one of the things, I guess, that makes the work of the American Film Institute so important. But at any rate, to get to a very important thing. As far back as, Michelangelo, as far as history serves us, we know that young artists serve their apprenticeship studying under the tutelage of their masters. But for some unknown reason in this country, it's sort of gone by the boards, that process of perpetuating the arts, as far as motion pictures and television goes. So, tonight, the American Film Institute is initiating the John Ford Fellowship Award. And out of over 500 applicants, 3 young film students have been chosen and given scholarships so that they may continue their work at the Center for Advanced Film Studies. And I'd like to introduce them right now, if I might. At table 201, I hope, would Mel Damsky, Ina May, and Leroy McDonald please stand up? There they are, and be acknowledged. behalf of all of us, I offer congratulations and the reminder that in your hands lies the future of one of the greatest native industries that America has ever known. So God bless and use it well, and if you happen to need an 80-year-old Irishman, you know. Thank you.
John Ford has made a movie for every one of the 25 letters in the alphabet. That's right. U, V, W, Y, Z. There was no X. And yet it almost happened once, quite by accident. See, in those years, Jack Ford was doing pictures where he would finish one night, and then he would go to bed and get up the next morning, and he would be sent a script, or given a script, and they never told him what it was, or what it was about, or who was in it. And he'd go on the set, and he'd start shooting the picture. Well, this one morning, he got up, and he went on the set, and there was a scene with a gentleman and a young lady, and the gentleman was supposed to kiss her. So he said, all right, roll him, or whatever his term was, and they started to perform, and Mr. Ford sat there, and he looked at it for a while, and he said, cut! He said, look, I know it's early in the morning, and I know that perhaps you're not up to it yet, but this scene is a scene in which you have to portray some emotion, some contact, some continuation of your feeling toward this woman. Now, you're supposed to kiss her. And if you're going to kiss her, take her in your arms, kiss her passionately, and kiss her like you really meant it. And the actor said, well, fine, Mr. Ford, I'll be happy to do anything you like, but I feel I should tell you that in this picture, this little girl plays my daughter. Now, all of Mr. Ford's pictures are rated G. Especially when they star the beautiful leading lady of How Green Was My Valley, the long gray line, and the quiet man. And when Maureen O'Hara steps out on that screen, you know immediately what G stands for. It's for gorgeous and gifted and glamorous and just plain G. G, look at that vision coming up.
President, ladies and gentlemen, and if you'll forgive me, more importantly, Mr. Sean Aloysius Kilmartin O'Feeney. Alias Mr. John Ford, sometimes Rear Admiral John Ford, but to all of us who love him so very, very dearly, he'll always be Pappy. And Pappy, with your permission tonight, I'd like to salute you and the Admiral's lady, Mary, by singing to you from the score of The Quiet Man. As I wake up one morning, the beat of the day, a farmer and his daughter I spied upon my way, and the girl, she sat quite to the milk and not from cow. Saying I will and I must get married, for the humor is on me now. Oh, the humor is on me now. Oh, the humor is on me now. For I will and I must get married, for the humor is on me. then awake. The heavens look bright, my dear. It's never too late for delight, my dear. And the best of all ways to lengthen our days is to steal a few hours from the night, my dear. Oh, initially, my I'm returning from wasted years across the wintry sea. And when
by John Ford. That credit has appeared on 140 films. It's a credit that has been well and truly honored. John Ford's the only director in the world that's received 6 Academy Awards and 4 New York Film Critic Awards, not to mention a score of other prizes from countries all around the world. John Ford's name on a picture has come to mean a special kind of quality. It's a quality that is runs so consistently throughout all of his films that they should not really be considered individually at all, but rather as a body of work, a single achievement that can stand alongside the works of the great authors, painters, and composers of the world. Films like Drums Along the Mohawk, Tobacco Road, She Wore a Yellow Ribbon, Mary of Scotland, The Long Voyage Home.
The Searchers. Mr. Lincoln.
What are you doing in Springfield?
Figuring on setting myself up as a lawyer.
What do you know about law, Abe?
Not enough to hurt me.
Stagecoach.
What started this fight?
I refuse to answer, sir.
Go ahead. Tell him, Reb. This fella here spoke real derogatory about the boy's pappy.
Yeah, and he also said he was the teacher's pet of a chowder-headed mixed sergeant. What's that mean, Doc?
Did you say that?
Yes, I did.
You did you?
Yes, I did.
Did you mean it, did you?
Yes, I did.
We'll settle this tonight, behind the picket line, soldier fashion, markers of Queensbury rules. Shouted face. What was it he said?
Chowder-headed Mick Sergeant.
Chowder-headed Mick. And you meant it, did you?
Yes, I did.
9 o'clock tonight, boys.
The man who shot Liberty Valance.
Looking at the new waitress. That's my steak, Valance. You heard him, dude. Pick it up.
No.
Pilgrim, hold it. I said you, Valance. You pick it up. 3-1, Donovan. My boy, Pumpy. The kitchen door.
I'll get it, Liberty.
I said you, Liberty. You pick it up.
What's the matter? Everybody in this country killed crazy? Here!
Of Eagles. Soldiers.
Hey,
poor Johnny. He's all I've got left. First his father, then his uncle. His brothers, now him. He's all I have left forever. I'm not going to let him go. I'm not going to let him go.
Cadet Drummer Buford, you are relieved of duty.
Back to the matter, Muley. After what them dusters done to the land, the tenant system don't work no more.
You don't grapes
even
of wrath.
Even, much less show a profit. Why, one man on a tractor can handle 12 or 14 of these places. You just pay him a wage and take all the crop.
Yeah, but we couldn't do on any less than what our share is now. Well, the children ain't getting enough to eat as it is. And they're so ragged. We'd be ashamed if everybody else's children wasn't the same way.
I can't help that. All I know is I got my orders. They told me to tell you to get off, and that's what I'm telling you.
You mean get off my own land?
Now, don't go into blaming me. It ain't my fault.
Whose fault is it?
You know who owns the land, the Shawnee Land and Cattle Company.
And who's the Shawnee Land and Cattle Company?
It ain't nobody. It's a company.
They got a president, ain't they? They got somebody who knows what a shotgun's for, ain't they?
Oh, son, it ain't his fault because the bank tells him what to do.
All right. Where's the bank?
Tulsa. What's the use of picking on him? He ain't nothing but the manager. And he's half crazy himself, trying to keep up with his orders from the east.
Then who do we shoot?
Brother, I don't know. If I did, I'd tell you. I just don't know who's to blame.
Well, I'm right here to tell you, mister, there ain't nobody gonna push me off my land. My grandpa took up this land 70 years ago. My pa was born here. We was all born on it. And some of us was killed on it. And some of us died on it. And that's what makes it ours. Being born on it and working on it and dying on it. And not no piece of paper with a writing on it.
Now, I'm proud to present to you the man who's been central to everything the American Film Institute has done from its earliest inception, our director, Mr. George Stevens, Jr.
We created the American Film Institute with a deep belief that the past and the future have an important connection. The history of art tells us that creativity is an inspiration for future generations. The trustees elected to establish an award to honor an individual each year who, in a fundamental way, had contributed to the advancement of the art of film. A person, most importantly, whose work had stood the test of time. Perhaps because he grew up near the sea, on the coast of Maine, it is that John Ford has told interviewers over the years that what he really wanted to be was a tugboat captain. Well, the fact is that God made him a poet, and we're all the better for it. I think Orson Welles probably said it better than anyone. When asked what he thought were the greatest American directors of all time, he answered simply, the great masters, John Ford, John Ford, and John Ford. We have just seen a few brief moments of John Ford's artistic vision. That film that was projected amounts to 0.1% of his life's work. And we must face the fact that through neglect, a great many of John Ford's films no longer exist. And mindful of that, the trustees have made a part of this award our pledge that we will preserve for all time, the surviving works of John Ford. Selecting the recipient for this first annual award, I have to tell you, was not difficult. We simply chose the man who stands alone as the most important director since the late D.W. Griffith, a man who has enriched our lives immeasurably, and there's a place for us too in his life, and we take that place tonight. It was another Yankee, the philosopher Henry Adams, who said, "He too serves a purpose who only stands and cheers." So I give you our purpose tonight in presenting this award for life achievement. I invite you to stand and cheer Mr. John Ford.
Mr. President, Mrs. Nixon, ladies and gentlemen, I'm overcome with gratitude. I wish I had the words to express my feelings, but I don't. But thank you all. Thank the American Film Institute, George Stevens, Jr., Bruce Hersington, all their colleagues. I am most grateful. Tonight is a most momentous occasion in the history and the annals of motion pictures. Tonight, the first time the chief executive of our nation has honored a public motion picture event with his presence. This is a night long to be remembered. Certainly will remind me. Thank you, Mr. President. We have a dignity and statue to our image. We are most grateful. And that's about all I can say before I break down. Thank you.
I don't think that I have ever been in a room that has been so charged with emotion in all the years that I can remember. See Duke Wayne and Jimmy Stewart and all the people at that table and all of the people in the audience move to tears is one of the most exciting and rewarding things I have ever seen in my life. And it engenders the most remarkable feeling of pride that I think I have ever felt in our profession, in my profession and in yours. Because I honestly believe that our profession is the single greatest self-sustaining democracy in the world. Never to my knowledge has anybody in my profession refused to walk out on the stage because there are members of different nationalities or faiths or colors in an audience. And by the same token, nobody has ever been refused admittance into our profession by virtue of what they were. Our criteria was very simple. How well do you do your job? And how well do you please your audience? And those standards have remained fairly constant throughout the world. And our profession as an art form has really created a brotherhood of man. And has become, I believe, the most singularly powerful weapon for communication, I think, in our times. It has educated. It has illuminated vast areas of darkness. It has brought entertainment to people throughout the world. It has become, I believe, a most remarkable profession. And in a profession where for many, many years, my friends, we have been sometimes laughed at and derided or scoffed at or even maligned, it's quite nice to know that we have earned every bit of respect that our profession now enjoys. And it is fitting that tonight we honor one of our own greats. And to all of us, I believe it is a tribute to the dignity and the growth of our profession in that we are all being honored tonight by the presence of the President of the United States.
And Mrs. Ford, all of our distinguished guests tonight. As most of you know, I have made many speeches in my life. I've never had a harder act to follow. It was, however, not an act, because everything that we've heard tonight was from the heart. And as I, with you, enjoyed this program, I thought that Mr. Ford would want me to say that tonight we honor a man. We think of him as a great man, one of the geniuses of his profession. But I think he would want me to say, speaking for all of the American people, we honor a great profession, all of the people in the motion picture profession. Thank you very much. I'm an unabashed movie fan. I think I've seen virtually all of the 140 movies. And I'm grateful to all of you in Hollywood, in this great profession, for making us first in the world in motion pictures and conveying through American motion pictures to the world what I believe is a complete picture of America and a good picture of America, because that is what you have done. I now come to my part in the program and the tribute to Mr. Ford. I have noted tonight that he has been characterized in several different ways. Some have called him boss. And others have called him Jack. And most have called him Pappy. But there was one term that I did not like. They called him a rear admiral. John Ford was never rear. And as commander-in-chief of the armed forces for the balance of this evening, John Ford is a full admiral. Second part of my presentation is one that gives me great honor. The President of the United States, as is always and should be in the free country, has to take positions and make speeches from time to time in which there is a difference of opinion among our people. However, there are rare occasions, and this is one of them, when he speaks for all the people. It used to be said in American politics, as Maine goes, so goes the nation. And in 1932, that proved not to be true. But tonight, as this son of Maine goes, so goes the nation. It isn't just a landslide, it's unanimous for John Ford. Through across the country. And therefore, I tonight speak for all of the American people, for millions of people around this world who respect and appreciate his genius. Because John Ford is one who, by what he has done, has earned the respect of not only his countrymen, but of others throughout the world. There's little that I can add to the citation that I will read to you in a moment, except to say that we can present to him only the highest civilian award that can be presented in this country. And its name is one that is very appropriate, because John Ford passionately loves freedom. John Ford, in his works, has depicted freedom in all of its profound depths, in all of its aspects to all of the world. And John Ford has fought for freedom. And for that reason, it is appropriate that tonight, on behalf of all of the American people, he received the Medal of Freedom. I now read the citation. The President of the United States of America awards the Presidential Medal of Freedom to John Ford. In the annals of American film, no name shines more brightly than that of John Ford. Director and filmmaker for more than half a century, he stands preeminent in the craft. Not only as a creator of individual films of surpassing excellence, but as a master among those who transformed the early motion pictures into a compelling new art form that developed in America and swept the whole world. As an interpreter of the nation's heritage, he left his personal stamp indelibly imprinted on the consciousness of whole generations, both here and abroad. In his life and in his work, John Ford represents the best in American films and the very best in America.
Thank you, sir. As Captain Jeremiah Dutton said, hope I get through with this. I'm about ready to bust out and cry. As Captain Denton says, as he stepped foot for the first time in many years in continental American soil, I'm stunned and bewildered at this reception. He ended with, God bless America. I quote his words with feeling. There are some people in this world that don't think that we movie folks have any religion. But a glance around this distinguished audience is a living refutation of that nonsense. I said, frankly, sir, I broke down, I blubbered and cried like a baby. Then I reached my rosary and said a few decades of the beads. And I heard a short pilgrim prayer, not an original prayer, but one that is spoken in millions of American homes today. It's a simple prayer. It's simply, God bless Richard Nixon. Thank you.
The American Film Institute. I want to thank all the people who made this tribute possible. And that literally includes people from all phases of film. Of course, a special thanks to our master of ceremonies, Mr. Danny Kaye. Finally, we're most indebted to the many members of the American Film Institute who have so unselfishly given their time and their money to help us in our efforts to preserve what is great in the past of American film so that we can ensure what will be great in its future. Thank you.